Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present Neptune Crossing, The Chaos Chronicles, Book 1, by Jeffrey A. Carver. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. Dedication for Julia Dakota Carver. There's a galaxy waiting for you out there. Chaos. Latin chaos, from the Greek vast chasm, abyss, void. Noun. 1. Common usage. Disorder. Infinite formlessness. 2. Human science. Seemingly disordered or turbulent systems from which hidden order may emerge. Consequences arising from sensitive dependence on initial conditions may be unpredictable, even theoretically. 3. Alien science. Energetic potential for growth and development in the universal order, which may be amplified by selective intervention in highly complex and apparently disordered systems, especially living systems. Prelude. Awakening in deep time. The cavern was cold, even in the slow energy flux of the translator's alien mechanisms. The Quarx did not feel the near-absolute zero cold, but was aware of it, as it awakened to the silence of a still world. Its first impression was not of place, but of time. Vast corridors of time through which it had floated in an almost coffin-like existence. What did millions of years mean when one was asleep, when one's life process was held like a cup of electrons in the hands of an angel? What did the passage of time mean, except that once more all the mortal lives it had known were gone? The awakening was difficult and confusing. There was so much to remember, and so much more to learn. The Quarx's translator had anticipated its confusion and was ready with information and explanations. Not too much at once, but enough. They were in the planetary system of a yellow sun, though at such a remove that the sun was a mere fleck of light in the sky. But there were other planets, closer to the sun, and there was life there, venturing outward. The Quarx and its translator watched and listened with growing interest. There was much to know, but always with the mission to be considered. The mission. The Quarx trusted that the translator knew what the mission was. The Quarx, who had known the translator for millions of years, still did not entirely understand the mind of the thing, or the minds of its creators. It might have understood those things once, but much of what the Quarx had once known, it had forgotten. How many worlds had it visited? How many suns? How many life forms? It didn't know, couldn't remember, but it knew enough to trust. It was the translator that swept the skies with its tendrils of awareness, the translator that computed the almost infinitely complex algorithms of chaos, the translator that recalled in its deepest memories just what it was they had been sent here to do. Footsteps. Visitors. It had been only a short wait, no time at all, compared to the eons that had passed before. The translator had seen to it that remnants of the moon's past had convected upwards to its icy surface, where traces might be noticed. Once the visitors were nearby, the Quarx and its translator kept their hushed silence, but began searching for the right individual, for one who would be willing to sacrifice everything for the sake of the mission. The mission. The Quarx already felt a sense of urgency. The computations were proceeding but not yet complete, but it knew that lives were at stake, as ever, more lives than it could count. And it knew that its own life, as ever, was expendable. And it knew that it could not act alone. There were few enough candidates with the right combination of qualities, the right potential. But they needed just one, and soon. They had grown accustomed to the glacial slowness of geologic time, but things were about to change drastically. Things were about to happen with lightning speed. One individual came into sharper focus. The more the Quarx and its translator watched this one, the more hopeful they became. Here was one who knew the presence of others in his mind, who felt at home with the tidal movement of data flow and the slow seep of intermingled consciousnesses. This one had recently lost that presence and suffered for the loss. He was drawing near now, unwittingly near. There might be no better opportunity to try. He was in a period of disruptive suffering, but perhaps that would help, make it easier to draw him in, like an animal into a snare. Sometimes the Quarx wished that it didn't always have to happen this way. Chapter 1. Triton Survey. John Bandicut couldn't have said exactly what made him drive his buggy past the invisible stop-here line east of Nav Point Wendy. It was almost as if the stately blue crescent of Neptune overhead was beckoning him onward, a deity calling him towards some mystical assignation among the rills and ravines of Triton. It was almost as if he had no choice. That was lunacy, of course. Bandicut took the rover across into the unsurveyed sector because he was half out of his mind with silence fugue. Though he was still perfectly capable of operating the equipment, he was hallucinating intermittently, and in some small corner of his mind he was aware that there was no way he should be out on the Triton surface risking his life, or for that matter, the company's equipment. Now, Bandicut cared about company equipment the way he cared about cockroaches. But where his own life was concerned, he generally, in more lucid moments, had a pretty strong survival instinct. But with each passing second, a little more of that lucidity was being swept away by the silence fugue, by the terrible emptiness that was devouring the inside of his head. It was not that there wasn't plenty of information pouring through his senses, a clear view of the Triton landscape through his visor, occasional comm chatter in his helmet, the metallic stink of recycled air in his nostrils, the taste of bile in his throat, the bouncing of the buggy under his seat. But inside, deep in his thoughts, there lurked a dark, echoing, reverberating silence. This was the worst he had ever had, the fugue. It felt as if some outside power were sucking his mind dry of even the memory of the flow and chatter and swarm of the neuro, stretching the inner silence as taut as a wire. He felt as if there were a black hole in his skull, and the only way to escape its awful hold was to flee physically across the Triton landscape. He twitched the joystick and steered the rover down a shallow ravine, racing away from the sector that he was supposed to be detail mapping. It was not a visibly hazardous direction. He was not looking for danger, but for escape. He should have known, of course, that he was escaping nothing. But he wasn't thinking. He was just responding to a desperate siren call in his mind in the awful silence. A call to drive his buggy toward the planet Neptune floating before him. In time, he became aware of the exo-op calling him. The voice clanged in his headset like a hammer striking a metal pole. "Unit Echo, Unit Echo, do you copy? Unit Echo base camp, what is your present location? Echo, Bandicut, are you there? For Christ's sake, answer!" He reached for the comm control as if to respond. Then he watched his hand turn the volume down to inaudibility. Now, why had he done that? The thought and the question were carried away on the waves of emptiness and silence. He was riding on a tide.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.